brothers and sisters, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Such a joy to gather and celebrate with you. And remember, Christmas is not just a day. It's not just a week. And even though the world around us has started to pack it all up, we continue celebrating. And so let us begin in the sign of our faith, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
As we open our hearts before the Lord, let us call to mind our sins. And asking God's forgiveness, let us prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries. Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you.
O God, who are pleased to give the shining example of the Holy Family, graciously grant that we may imitate them in practicing the virtues of family life and in the bonds of charity, and so in the joy of your house, delight one day in eternal rewards, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Sirach. God sets a father in honor over his children. A mother's authority he confirms over her sons. Whoever honors his father atones for sins and preserves himself from them. When he prays, he is heard. He stores up riches, who reveres his mother. Whoever honors his father is gladdened by children, and when he prays, is heard. Whoever reveres his father will have a long life. He who obeys his father brings comfort to his mother. My son, take care of your father when he is old. Grieve him not as long as he lives. Even if his mind fail, be considerate of him. Revile him not all the days of his life. Kindness to a father will not be forgotten. Firmly planted against the debt of your sins, a house raised in justice to you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, put on as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, heartfelt compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If one has a grievance against another, as the Lord has forgiven you, so must you also do. And over all these, put on love. That is the bond of perfection. And let the peace of Christ control your hearts, the peace into which you were also called in one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, as in all wisdom you teach and admonish one another, singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
With you.
With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
When the days were completed for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they took him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, just as it is written in the law of the Lord. Every male that opens the womb shall be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer the sacrifice of a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons, in accordance with the dictate and the law of the Lord. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, awaiting the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he should not see death before he had seen the Christ of the Lord. He came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to perform the custom of the law in regard to him, he took him into his arms and blessed God, saying, "Now, Master, you may let your servant go in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen the salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and glory for your people Israel." The child's father and mother were amazed at what was said about him, and Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, "Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be contradicted, and you yourself a sword will pierce, so the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed." There was also a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived 7 years with her husband after her marriage, and then as a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple, but worshiped night and day with fasting and prayer. And coming forward at that very time, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were awaiting the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had fulfilled all the prescriptions of the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My brothers and sisters, Sunday during the octave of Christmas is set aside as a celebration for the feast of the Holy Family. When we think of the Holy Family, they may warm our hearts with devotion and with joy. We may think of our nativity scenes, we may think of stained glass or images in our churches. And as much as we might be inspired and drawn by this image, it might seem a little bit foreign and a little bit distant. Because when we think of the Holy Family, well, we think of Jesus, fully human but also fully God. We may think of Mary, born without original sin. And then, of course, we think of Joseph, fully human as we are, but a righteous man, one who listened and followed the will of God. And so they seem almost too perfect, calling them the Holy Family because of their openness to the will of God, because of the power of God guiding them throughout their lives. Our temptation might be to set them on a pedestal, to venerate them, but to say our family life, our own experience, is so human, so earthy, so ordinary, that this family doesn't have much to say to us. But nothing could be further from the truth, because in speaking of the Holy Family, we're not speaking of plaster cast saints. We're not speaking of a people who knew no suffering, who knew no peril. In fact, we're speaking of people who feared for their lives, who fled because a new persecution was coming. We speak of a mother who, yes, she was a mother of the incarnate Son of God, but right from the beginning, the storm clouds seemed to gather. And as much as she rejoiced in the birth of her son, as much as she rejoiced in God's blessing, time and again she was reminded that this blessing would come with suffering. And that suffering certainly would lead to redemption and salvation of many. But it's hard to bear all that in balance. And then, of course, we think of Joseph, just like us, human like us, born with original sin like us, and wrestling to understand and follow the will of God. What he teaches us, though, is important. He teaches us that as children of God, our mission in this life is to listen to God's voice. Our mission in this life is to follow the will of God, even when it doesn't make sense, even when we don't understand it. And again, in today's gospel, we are reminded who hears the will of God. It's not necessarily the wise and the learned, the rich and the comfortable, those in prestige. Those that hear the will of God, whether poor or wealthy, whether well-known or kind of faded into the common sea of humanity, are those who have prepared their hearts to receive it. Today's gospel presents us with two elders, Simeon and Anna, two people who knew that yearning in their hearts for the fulfillment of God's law and his promises, two people who in their lives knew suffering, knew rejection, but who constantly kept their eyes firmly, seeking God's will. Anna, in particular, as a widow, we have to remember that in the time she lives, to be a widow was to fade into the background. So much prestige and dependence was given to the role of the husband that when the wife was left, particularly without children, there was great suffering, great destitution. And she could rightly have faded into sorrow and dejection. But her faith was firm, and her faith rooted her in a belief and the God who fulfills all promises. And so she continued being that woman of faith, that woman of prayer, seeking to see and love the will of God. And her faithfulness and her constancy was rewarded. As we look at our lives, as we look at our families, I'm sure that these figures resonate with people we may know. They may even resonate with our lives that have gone through trials, through difficulty, through waiting, through wondering and saying, Lord, I trust in you. I've read your word. I've celebrated the sacraments. I know that you will fulfill your law and your desire, but I don't know when. And sometimes that waiting feels too long. Feels like a day after day, year after year passes. And we might not understand the unfolding of what God desires for us. But what these two figures, what Simeon and Anna teach us, is that God unfolds, not in great and dramatic gestures, but in the constancy of being faithful, in that daily relationship of prayer, of opening our hearts before him with everything that is inside. God doesn't desire perfect, beautiful piety from us if it's not authentic. Rather, he would be much happier with faithful prayer, even if it's gritty, even if it's real, even at times if our prayer feels messy and the words don't quite fit in the most beautiful way. But if they come from the heart, that is what God wants. Because in the heart is where God wants us to live. In our hearts is where God comes to greet us, as we heard in today's second reading from St. Paul. St. Paul speaks to us of love. And we have to remember that when we use that word love, it's not just a simple attraction, it's not just simple affection. It's not a bond that's easy to break. When we speak of love, we speak of God's life. We speak of that life that brings us to existence, that life that unites us to others, that life that sustains us in good times and in bad through sickness and in health, that life which reminds us that we are more than our limitations, we are more than our defects, and we're certainly more than our sins. To place the Holy Family on a pedestal and to say they're too far from our reach is not to trust in God's goodness and in what he wants to say and do in our lives. Because the reality, my brothers and sisters, though we may be far from the goal at this point, all of us are called to be saints. And the saint is not that plaster cast figure with not a hair out of place, not a scuff or a scar. The saint is a person who fully engaged in life, who might have been tossed around a bit, who might have stumbled and fallen, but kept getting back up. Scars are not signs of defeat. They are signs that we faced a battle and challenge, and we survived. So as you look at your lives, as you look at your weaknesses, as you look at your sins, don't give up. Get up. Ask God for that grace to try anew, to remember the love he has for you. And if you think you're outside of the bonds of God's love because of who you are, because of what you've done, you're wrong. The fact that you exist, the fact that you are alive, is God saying to you, I love you and I am with you. And so today, as we celebrate the Holy Family, we ask their intercession. We ask the intercession of Simeon and Anna. We ask the intercession of all those figures of faith who have gone before us, those who have walked in our own lives, and we look at them in admiration and perhaps sometimes a little bit of envy, but we ask their intercession, that our hearts may be as firmly rooted in the Lord, that when we stumble and fall, we don't give up, but get up, go back to the Lord, and continue that journey until we come to our Heavenly Father's dwelling, where he is waiting for all of us. There's not a select few that he said, these are my favorite, and the rest of you, good luck. Because again, my brothers and sisters, if we exist and if we live, it is out of God's love. And it is through that love that he sustains us. And it is in that love that he will greet us when we come home. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Trusting that God fulfills his promises, let us now present him with our prayers.
For Pope Francis, may the Lord bless him in his zeal and joy for the gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our elected officials, may the Holy Spirit conform their hearts to charity and justice as they make their governing decisions. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That young men and women will listen to the Holy Spirit in their hearts and respond to the cry from deep within. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may be mindful of our mission to live out the commandment to love God and our neighbor by our participation at Mass and reception of the Eucharist. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intention of this Mass, the people of the Catholic Parishes of Stoughton, for all those who have died, for the souls in purgatory, and for Angela Mazzone, may they know the mercy of God in the kingdom of heaven. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for the prayers and intentions each of us brings to this Mass, particularly for those in our lives who have wandered far from the love of God, that they may come back home to the Father's embrace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and merciful God, we thank you and praise you that you never give up on us, that you call us ever to new life and raise us up from our brokenness to share in your glory. We ask you to hear our prayers and to answer them, through Jesus Christ, who is your Son and our Lord, and through the intercession of his Blessed Mother, as together we say, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Thank you.
sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, our Almighty Father. We offer you, Lord, the sacrifice of conciliation, humbly asking that through the intercession of the Virgin Mother of God and Saint Joseph, you may establish our families firmly in your grace and your peace, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For through him the holy exchange restores our life, has shown forth today in splendor. When our frailty is assumed by your word, not only does human mortality receive unending honor, but by this wondrous union, we too are made eternal. And so in company with the choirs of angels we praise you, and with joy we proclaim. Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself. So from the rising of the sun to its setting, pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, proclaim passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Sean Patrick, our bishop, and his assistant bishops, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you've summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you with their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Refresh with this heavenly sacrament, most merciful Father, to imitate God's example of the Holy Family, so that after the trials of this world, we may share their company forever, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying God by your lives.
Thanks be to God.
And have a great week and a blessed beginning to 2021, everybody.